at the end of the session. You're requested to keep your questions brief so we can take more number of questions. Welcome to the 10th Z Jaipur Literature Festival at Darbar Hall. Our next session for the day is Engaging with India, the Margins and the Mainland. The speakers are Dhrubajyoti Bora. Please welcome all of them with a round of applause. Dhrubajyoti Bora, Sanjoy Hazarika, Teresa Rehman, in conversation with Urvashi Butalia. Urvashi is a publisher and writer, co-founder of India's first feminist publishing house, Kali for Women. She writes on a range of issues to do with women and gender. Over to you, Urvashi.
Thank you. Hello, everyone, and welcome. Nice to see this place filled up. It's a small venue, but it's great to see it filled up, and we're going to have a good conversation. So let me start by introducing our panelists, and then I'll put a bit of the subject before you, and then we'll get straight off into the conversation. Teresa Rehman is a journalist from Assam. And Teresa writes that she has a dream, and that is to make the voices of the Northeast audible and the people of the Northeast visible to the world. And through her journalism, that is what she tries to do. She has written for mainstream media and continues to write columns, but she now runs a web magazine of her own called The Thumbprint, through which she tries to reach not only the states, the eight states of the Northeast, but also India and the rest of India and also internationally. Teresa, welcome. Teresa has just had a new book out called The Mothers of Manipur, which she has in her hand, if you'd like to just put it up and show it, and which is on sale in the bookshop. Please feel free to go there and get it. Dhrubajyoti Bora, who is one of the most respected writers in Assam. He's also a medical doctor. And another way of introducing him is he's one of the best known medical doctors who's also a writer from Assam. I don't know which of those takes priority for you. He has till recently been president of the Assam Sahitya Academy. In 2009, he won the Sahitya Academy Award. Of course, he's a winner of, recipient of many other awards. I shan't list them all. He's a novelist, writes in Assamese, a historian, an essayist, a journalist, somebody who also writes short fiction, and who also writes for newspapers and magazines. He is an editor of a quarterly magazine called Yatra. And you used to edit another magazine called, I've forgotten it. Adi Samai. And he has recently published a novel in English, his first novel in English. Do you have a copy here that we can show everybody?
Yeah.
So the Sleepwalker's Dream, it's the story of a small group of militants and a young woman who gets accidentally caught with them. Running for shelter, hiding from the security forces, and the ways in which they think and rethink their past lives and engage with each other. Sanjoy Hazarika, who actually needs little introduction to Jaipur audiences, he's been here many times before. Sanjoy is many things. He's a human rights activist and writer on human rights issues. He currently heads an institution called the Commonwealth Human Rights Institute in Delhi. Previous to that, Sanjoy was with the Center for Northeast Research at the Jamia Millia Islamia in Delhi. And that center designed a really interesting, very effective program on health in and around villages and places that are lie on the Brahmaputra River in Assam. These are boat clinics which go out and provide medical care and attention to people. Sanjoy is also author of many books. Among the first people to start writing about the Northeast, his first, was it your first book, Strangers in the Mist, or second?
Second.
Yes, the second book. The first book on the Northeast. So that made a lot of waves and continues to be in print today. He has since written several more, not only on the Northeast, but various other places. And he lives and works in Delhi, but shuttles between Delhi and Northeast states. He's also a film maker, I guess, and has recently, you've recently made a film on Mizoram, right? Sort of high-powered panel, everybody a person of many parts. We're going to talk about engaging with India. I just want to lay on the table a few things that we will be discussing. So traditionally, within India, the northeastern states, eight of them, are seen as somehow outliers, marginal, and although they form a resource base for much of the raw material that comes into the country, they have received less than their fair share of attention, governance, care, engagement, all of those things. The people of the Northeast, who are extremely varied, and within each state, you get many different communities and groups who have been there. And the Northeast has traditionally also been a place which has had a lot of in-migration into its states. And in recent years, a lot of out-migration, not only to urban India, but also to other parts of the world, where Northeastern young people go to work in different trades, including hoteliering and various others. So it's been a place which has been marked by in-migration, which has been a very contentious issue, but also now out-migration, which is an equally contentious issue in somewhat different kinds of ways. Because some people in the Northeast look slightly different because of the sort of affinity to the Mongoloid sort of races, they are marked out as the other in what is seen as mainland India, and often discriminated against. In particular, in recent months, when you heard a lot about sexual violence against women, if the woman was from the Northeast, the news reports would always say Northeastern girl, as if to say that that marked something about the woman. So it's again been a very troubling issue for people from there. How do they integrate? How do they engage with what they call the mainland? But it is no longer a one-way thing. How does this happen one way? It works both ways. Also, I think in recent years, there's an increasing awareness that within the Northeast itself, there are engagements to be had between the different states, between the different peoples, and there are power hierarchies. So Assam, from where all three of our speakers come, is the state which has the most attention, the most power, a large number of writers come from there, large number of journalists come from there. So within the Northeast also, and within Assam itself, there are different peoples, different races, different tribes who are there. So the issue is not so easily dealt with. And as you know, the JLF opened with this rather wonderful Shillong choir. So that's more and more you start to see musicians, cooks, designers, others from the Northeast making it, I'm using the word in quotes, in mainland India, but also engaging with their own states back in the Northeast. So I'm going to ask our speakers to address this issue of what actually, and I want to start with you, Dhrubajyoti ji, what does it mean for you to engage with India? What is India for you, and what are the different kinds of discriminations you face, if at all? It's working.
Okay. You see, the perception is very important. Perception of so-called margin and perception of so-called the center. It is important for us to discuss this first. You know, in a lighter vein, perception of the margin of the center is something like this, that in a big metro like Delhi, which is the capital, or Calcutta, or Mumbai, there sits a group of very clever people, politicians, bureaucrats, businessmen, traders, who had been from the times before independence, and specifically after independence, looting the developmental funds that have been earmarked for the Northeast. So this is a common perception. And this loot is stupendous, it's horrendous. The how over the years, despite the funds being allotted, people could loot in such a way, sometimes without even doing the work, sometimes in the name of huge subsidies that the government, they have made the government to take policies that if you transport certain thing to the Northeast, you get subsidy. If you open an industry in Northeast, you get subsidy. Subsidies everywhere, and the whole subsidies are looted without doing anything much. And from the mainland, possibly, it is something like this, that in the Northeast, there lives gullible people, unread, corrupt politicians who can be bought for a price and with whose help you can really make money there and make money not by doing work, make money without doing work. That has been a common perception from the periphery and also from the center, because that day one of my friends have heard a very gentleman commenting in the JLF about one of the icons of Assamese culture who went from Rajasthan, whose forefathers rather went from Rajasthan, married there, and Jyoti Prasad Agarwala, he made the second Indian film in Assamese. That was the second Indian film. So it was said that he went there taking 50 paisa coin in his pocket and then emerged as big as Rabindranath Tagore. Now this form of speech also, this kind of expressions also inform us as to what is the perception still going on. It was only 3 days back. Now, you see, when we negotiate, when our people come here, as Urvashi has beautifully said, and I had also talked with Sanjoy, that there is a lot of in-migration and out-migration. Lakhs of students from Northeast Assam come read in Delhi, Pune, and all the places where there are good institutions. They stay there. And a lot of people are coming out for work also. So you will find that in the south, in the Mumbai side, after the Gurkhas have left, the security personnel are from the Northeast. So it is like that. So what is happening? When they engage with the society, they found that there is discrimination. And this discrimination smacks of racism. And does not feel nice, but one has to acknowledge the fact that since these people look different, they are mainly Mongoloid, slanting eyes, small eyes, hairless faces. Mongoloid origin is much more. And since they speak different, mainly they speak a very bad Hindi, especially in North India, that Hindi, it's immediately apparent, though it's improving, I won't say that it's not improving, but they speak bad Hindi. Amongst themselves, they speak in English, which marks out, because we have to speak in English amongst ourselves. We don't know each other's language, so outside also we speak in English. Now their dresses are different. They carry guitars sometimes because music is very, they're very fond of music. And all this marks them apart, the other as you have said it. And this is happening and this is, I won't say that there are some sort of racial element, racism is not there in Assam also, but when we come out to rest of the India, we face this. And this is very real, this is dangerous. We have to acknowledge it, we have to be very conscious about it, and we have to engage with it, fight with it, so that within our country these things no longer continues or doesn't happen.
Thank you, Dada. So let me turn some of the points that Dada's made to you, Teresa, because it is true that the Northeast is exploited as a resource base. It is true that there are corrupt politicians who siphon off the funds, etc. My question is, I have two questions. One is there a resistance in the Northeast to this? And why is there that there hasn't been a strong battle, or has there? And secondly, when you talked about people looking different, you know, flat faces and slanting eyes and so on, but you people from Assam don't look particularly different. You could be from anywhere. So do you face less discrimination? I mean, what are your struggles in trying to engage with the mainland, so to speak?
Thank you, Urvashi. I was also thinking about the Shillong Chamber Choir when I read the topic again today in the morning, the margins and the mainland. I mean, who is the margins? I mean, where the Shillong Chamber Choir by any chance margin, marginal. So I would also like to narrate one small incident when I had come to Delhi, to receive the Ramnath Goenka Excellence in Journalism Award in a posh hotel. And I was sitting next to my another awardee who was also a journalist. And she asked me, where are you from? I said, I'm from Assam. So she exclaimed, wow, So that wow can be interpreted in many ways,
It's envy, like, envy.
Or maybe it was like, you've come from this exotic, fantastic land to Delhi. Oh, you managed to come here to receive this award, So this is where, I somehow refuse to be bogged down by these stereotypes. And I don't know, it's a personal battle. I want to defy these stereotypes, bust the myths. And I want to, this control narrative that is coming out from the Northeast over the decades, this is something which I strongly resent. And this is what I'm trying to tell through my book as well. It's like there are stories waiting to be told. And, as a journalist, it has been, I call myself a survivor. I used to work for a national magazine called Tehelka when I used to report for the Northeast. After I quit Tehelka, I started writing, I used to write pieces and I used to send out to all the so-called national media, so-called national newspapers. And I just waited, they didn't respond, and these were not bad stories. I mean, these were stories of global standards, that I was confident of. So then I started publishing with Himal South Asia, Kanak is here. And, so I had to find space in a different country, that's Kathmandu. And so, then I decided to create my own space. I refused to beg for space, and this is where I discovered the might of the internet. And I set up my own webzine. And it's amazing that, sitting in a small living room in a sitting in my living room in a small town in Assam, not even Guwahati. I live 200 kilometers away from the nearest airport. And I've been running this magazine, which has stormed its way into cyberspace. It's just been 4 years now, and we are known. I mean, we have managed to create a credible space. So I think this kind of, and when you see the Shillong Chamber Choir, I mean, they were of, by any chance, in the global standards, so these kind of things, which are, I think these kind of resistance, this is one kind of resistance, this is one form of defiance. I don't want to be bogged down by these stereotypes. This is something which, very subtle changes I can see, especially among the youth, I don't know what lies in future, but you know, these kind of changes, at least I find in my generation.
No, I think definitely there are changes that are visible, and people like you and Sanjoy and Dada. I have to call you Dada. No?
Dhruva.
Okay. So you are, in a sense, the outliers or the pioneers trying to make those breakthroughs, which today you see a lot more engagement because the barriers and the boundaries are breaking down. So even things like food kitchens in urban areas, which showcase cuisines from the Northeast, from different Northeastern states, fashion, bookshops, photography, things, poetry, music is a big thing. So all that is actually creating an awareness and changing in some ways the demographic even of the cities where people go. And changing, Sanjoy, would you say, the perception of the Northeast as primarily a region of conflict into something much more varied and nuanced?
Well, let me just start very simply by picking up on something that Dhruva said here, that, you know, there's this group of people who looting the Northeast, and I think a lot of our leaders and are not above that. They're very much into the loot and boot.
Can you hold the mic a little closer?
The thing is that, you know, day for yesterday I was coming by bus from the hotel here, and I heard somebody speaking in Assamese on the phone on the bus. So I asked her, "Are you Assamese?" She said yes. She was married to one of the writers who is a business executive in Singapore and has published here. Then I was sitting next to somebody who said his best friend, who's now an IAS officer, is from Shillong. And also in the two seats ahead was Teresa, Rehman. So I said that the Northeast is here. It's there. It's everywhere. We are not going anywhere. We've come here to stay. And I think this is something that the whole concept, the premise of engaging with India, is that it's a daily engagement for people who are contesting, as your son perhaps has to deal with in Delhi University. But it is not an embrace. We are not being embraced. We are resisted the embrace, and we are not embracing. But we are negotiating spaces. We are negotiating. We are engaging. And I always say this, that if you look around, you look to those of you who come from Delhi, you look around Delhi, you'll find that Delhi is the ninth city, the ninth state of the Northeast. Things are changing. India is changing. In the last 20 years, the Northeast may not have become a kinder, less corrupt, or better governed state, but it is certainly changing in terms of the people who are coming out. So you have a situation where this region, and I call it our Northeast, let's not call it the Northeast, it's our Northeast, you're people from Rajasthan, you're from Delhi, you're from Tamil Nadu. We do not say Southern India. You'll say Tamil Nadu or Kerala. So we are also from Assam and from Manipur and Nagaland and so on. But for the first time in the history of the region, it's become a migrant producing region, not just taking in migrants. And in this process, I think what you were saying right at the beginning, Urvashi, and what Dhruva and Teresa were saying, is that a lot depends on the nazar, you know, nazariya, the look, the gaze, as Bimal Okoyajam often says, the gaze. But the thing is that there's somebody looking back. The gaze is not just one way, the gaze is also of the person looking back. And I think the fact that people are coming out to take part in educational institutions, professions, they're teaching, they're everywhere. You know, not just in BPOs and beauty parlors and answering phone calls and so on. So I think that is something that we need to recognize is a mantham that is taking place. Because we are on the cusp of South Asia and Southeast Asia. That we cannot deny. And it is extremely a very complex and representative and a complex area, which is difficult to represent by people like us. We are from one state. We come from different backgrounds. But I think it's very important to recognize that that complexity is being translated into engagement with, you know, now if you just take the one area you left out was sports. The Indian soccer team has a majority of people from Manipur, Mizoram, and Nagaland. Those are the players.
There's also a Manipur women's polo team, which travels to Rajasthan at the time of the JLF and does events.
So I think that...
Hockey also, somebody's shouting out.
Well, Mary Gom, I'm now an MP, but I guess she still boxes, whether she boxes in Parliament or not, I don't know. But it's, so these are the things that I see, which are very important to accept. I mean, I agree that there is discrimination. I agree that there are these horrible things that happen. But I also see 10 years ago, you would not get an organized protest on the streets of Delhi, saying we will not accept it. We are not going to bow down. We are not going to bend the knee. We have done it in the Northeast, in terms of conflicting with the idea of India. But no, engagement is, in a peaceful manner, we say, this is unacceptable. And you force the government to, in some limited way, whatever it is, to say, yes, you have a point, we are looking into this, and we are engaged with it also. We want to change the law. So there is recognition, and there is engagement. And I think the two feed into each other.
But in some ways, exactly what you say, that the gaze, how you return the gaze, and how, let's say, the mainland, within quotes, engages with the Northeast, is also an important story, and the engagements within the Northeast. So, Teresa, for example, your work on the Imas of Manipur, who staged the naked protest. Now, that naked protest is something that hit the headlines the world over, and provided a model of women's resistance that you don't very often see, or you see it in a somewhat different form with the women from Ukraine who came across into France and, you know, used their bodies to protest. But that was a whole different engagement. So in a sense, the Northeast, many of the states of the Northeast, particularly Manipur, but also Nagaland, have provided very strong models of women's engagement, women's resistance to different kinds of discrimination. When you were writing as an Assamese journalist about Manipuri women, because notions of who is the outsider, insider, very strong in northeastern states also, how were you received? How did you feel about the writing? Were you at all worried about being the outsider? And I'm using all these words in quotes.
Urvashi, I, while writing this book, I was both an outsider and an insider, you know. I was an insider in the sense that I was from the region. I could empathize with the people. I could understand their angst and their sensibilities, and and I was also an outsider because I was not a Manipuri. I didn't look like one. I don't dress like one. But yes, I love Manipuri food. So you know that there is this. I wanted to write this book because it was, I felt that, you know, this whole discourse on conflict in the Northeast was very, very masculine. Mm. You know, you talk about guns, you talk about AK-47s, you talk about this, it's like mere statistics of people dying. But, you know, what about those the people of the Northeast, the people of Manipur, for instance, and these women, you know, because they come from a very conservative society, I was really intrigued. You know, I had these stories buried within me. I had met them several times. I used to go to their house. They used to cook for me. I used to sit with them, and then, you know, I waited that somebody would write it, somebody from Manipur would write it. But then I thought, you know, let me write it. I could not hold on any longer. And, you know, that was something which I felt that, you know, these women had stories, and they were very controlled in their narrative as well. You know, they know what to talk. And these are like stories which were told and retold, and one of them told me that maybe we have become part of history books or museums. And you know, this like for instance, you know, this mother, this Ima, she used to you know, she told me, oh, I said, oh, Ima, you don't have a gray hair at all. You know, no, I dye my hair. You know, I have to look good too, you know. So this is, you know, they're like real human beings, you know, talking about their lives. And one of them, she was an actor once upon a time. So she shows me her photograph as a screensaver on her mobile. See, I used to be so beautiful, you know. So, and then, you know, there are things like, you know, it was a very conservative society. Like when you wear your fanek, the lower garment, you're not supposed to show your, you know, heels. So that is something which, you know, you consider high-handed if you do that. And one of the mothers told me that, you know, I even when I go to sleep, I cover myself with my enafi, that upper garment. So for these women to go out and strip themselves, it's not a joke, you know. It's, and they were like, one of them also told me, I felt like it was the last day of my life.
Yeah,
you know?
I remember.
So these are the things which, you know, I felt that. And then I also tried to weave in other stories of men, women from Manipur. For instance, this doctor from Birmingham, this Manipuri doctor, he lives in the UK, and he was looking out of his clinic, and he saw those beautiful flower beds. He saw those beautiful flower beds, which is very common in the European countries. And then he felt that, oh, we don't seem to grow flowers. Why don't we grow flowers in Manipur? You hardly find a house with a beautiful lawn with nicely manicured, you know, flower beds. So he started this project called Blooming Manipur. That only when you grow flowers, you tend to the plants, you water the plants, you develop a love for your soil. So, you know, these kind of things. And then there's this model called Lynn Nystrom. She's also part of my book. And she was packed off at the age of 8 from Imphal to be an archer. And then later she becomes a model. And when, you know, it's the story starts with a flashback. You know, she's standing at the...
I'm going to ask you to stop there, because if you tell all the stories, nobody will buy your book. So you have to, yeah, you have to hold on to some of the stories.
Just the last point about Lynn Nystrom is like, you know, she went to audition for the role of Mary Kom.
Yes,
but she was not selected because, you know, she didn't look Indian enough, you know, so Priyanka Chopra.
That's true. That's
true. That is something, but she didn't mind, you know, she thought that, okay, it's like, you know, Manipuri, it's the
Sanjoy, thing. I know you want to say something, and do you want to come in first? I have a question for Dhruba also, but if you want to come in first, you do that and then I'll come.
Yeah, you see, this whole notion of discrimination, the fact is that it's more difficult in areas to deal with, in those areas where discrimination is actually installed, as it were, by law. Mm. So you have something like the Armed Forces Special Powers Act, which is in place in several states of the region, despite the fact, and this is a point I wanted to make earlier, that the insurgencies of the region, which were like the flavor of the month of the 60s, 70s, 80s and 90s, have petered down. Mm. They are no longer at a level that they were, and possibly, hopefully, they'll never be. Because people are tired. They want to live what is called a normal life. And they are part of the reason for the engagement with Delhi, with other parts of India, with Jaipur, Tamil Nadu, Kerala, wherever, is that people want to live lives that they see other people in other parts of the country living. I think that's very important. The second thing on this issue of discrimination is I'm coming to you from a conversation with the Delhi police, where they're saying that we need to train our people in sensitization. Can you develop a tool for us, a module for us, so that we understand better what the issues are for the people who come from that region, from our Northeast? So I think that there are things which are happening, which are also important, incipient, but they are taking place. I mean, the first part is inception always. So.
Yeah, in fact, I'm glad you raised that, because you've kind of taken the question from me. I was going to refer to the conflict and the Armed Forces Special Powers Act and the fact that many states are caught in conflict, and how these kinds of engagements that we've been talking about, do they take away the attention from the conflict in some ways? Because they're so much easier to talk about, or is there a need? And you've said that the conflicts themselves have kind of declined, and physical conflict. And your book, The Sleepwalker's Dream, so describes one of those declines, if you like, the ways in which the militants, whatever you call them, the UGs, the militants, are completely lost for a cause, for an identity, for leadership, for meaning, all of those things, right? You chose to write this book in English. And this is this for you, this choice, another form of engagement? Because when you're writing in Assamese, even though you may have a larger audience than English, you are writing within Assam and for the Assamese diaspora who are able to read Assamese. So is English a political choice of that nature?
No, to start with, it was not Urvashi. Mm-hmm. Actually, what happened, mm-hmm. I was educated in England in my school days. When I came back, I completely forgot the English language because I went into a vernacular school in Assamese. My schooling is in Assamese. Then, when I occasionally write, especially my professional writing is entirely in English, then I thought, can I write in English? Then I thought that if any of my book is taken up by a respectable publisher, then I will know that I can also write in English. It never had a bigger ambition than this book. But now,
but
looking back,
I
think that possibly in the subconscious, the reaching out to a wider audience, and you can say that politically this is a way of engagement, maybe it is true also.
Maybe it is true, you're not sure of it.
I'm not very sure because it didn't start off like that.
Hmm.
It didn't start off with a conscious thing. And my main concern today is that we are losing our regional languages. You see, some of our regional languages are so rich and so varied, up being of world standard. Mm. Even my own language is very rich and varied, but we are losing them because the school education is, people are, especially the elite, are entirely shifting from the regional language medium into English. So this has been a big concern of mine, and I am trying all over India to gather, support for this, to intervene in government policy. But that apart, we will have to live with this, that we will have to engage, and to engage we will need, languages, whether it is Hindi or whether it is English, that we will need. At the same time, we have to develop our own languages. We don't know where they will go and stand and end up.
Mm-hmm.
So my writing in this book in English is possibly what I have told you is the truth.
So here's an additional question for any of you who'd like to take it up, which is that as you have all pointed out, the engagement with India comprises many things, and a lot of the out-migration from the Northeast of largely young people. It's largely the young who are going out, which leaves behind an aging population in many of the places. So first, you were losing, many states were losing the young to militancy, to the conflict, and to drugs, because there was joblessness and so on. So that remains a huge issue there. And now, in a sense, you're losing them to the big cities, the draw of the big city, the draw of the overseas job, which is in the nature of things, which is what happens. But does it leave behind an impoverished culture which will not renew itself because the young are going away? Is there a concern you have about that? Is there a loss built into the engagement which takes the Northeast to the so-called mainland, mainstream, whatever you call it?
I will start with what Sanjoy says, that our economy has changed in the way that Keralites are going out to the Gulf. The Tamil Nadu people are coming to Kerala. But in this, I don't see that they are losing culture.
Mm-hmm.
culture is still vibrant in these areas, and I believe in the Northeast it will be vibrant. We are having a different form of economy at the moment that is still budding, that is remittance economy. Yes, old people are left behind, but say total migrant population will be around 10-15 to 20% at the most. Even not, it cannot go beyond that. So I don't think that is actually there.
You need to hold the mic a little bit higher. People can't hear you.
So I don't think our economy is changing. We are going into a remittance economy, just like Sanjay said. And but still, at the most, 15-20% of the people can go out. So the culture will remain vibrant and things will live. I think that worry we don't have to do, seeing the example of Kerala or seeing the example of Tamil Nadu in this case, or even other areas. This is from where Sanjay has left, I have picked up.
Well, I'll pick up on that. I think it's very interesting what you just said. I mean, apart from the remittance economy to some degree, I think what is happening, cultures travel with people. The food travels, the music travels, maybe it morphs. But you have, for instance, in Bangalore, one of the largest communities of Assamese entrepreneurs, students, professionals, writers, and they have in Gurgaon, in Delhi, they have these huge events celebrating, showcasing Assam's culture, the festivals, and every community. Like, for instance, you know, some years ago when I'd gone to give a talk in Delhi University, I discovered at that time that the Naga Students' Union alone, this is about 10 years ago, was 4,000 strong. Today it is at least 3 to 5 times that number. So people celebrate their identity wherever they are. It is not as if they are losing it. And they keep going back to renew their connection. They may not go back to stay, to live, to settle, some will. But I think this is very important, and it's like, that's why I said it's in our face. Almost. We are here, we're going to stay, and you better get used to the idea. I think that's a very important thing. The other area which I think is important, especially in a festival like this, to know, is that earlier, Zuban was publishing a lot of literature from the Northeast. There were some other publishers like Penguin and so on who did. But now we find it is not just with the niche publishers, with the committed media, with the committed publishers, but also in the mainstream publishing house, which is taking translations as well as writing, fresh writing from the region. And I think that is also a statement that we are recognizing this. I mean, I hope at the next Jaipur Lit Fest, we don't have a session on the Northeast. We should have a session on perhaps writers from all regions and what they write. You know, I think our Northeast or the Northeast is something that division needs to go, perhaps. You know, and we're also aware, you know, that some of you have made it your life's passion and commitment to get this narrative. I mean, there's you, there's Preeti, there's others who are making this as a commitment to the area, in addition to everything else that you do. And I think we're all grateful for that.
Teresa, do you have anything to add?
Yeah, actually I know of many people who have been in the so-called mainland and gone back. Like, I'm one of them. I was in Delhi, I studied here, I worked here, and then I went back. So I know of this singer called Akhu. He's also part of a character in my book. So he did his PhD in physics from Delhi University, and then he did his postdoc from Thailand, and then he came back to Imphal, and he's now using music to heal, you know. So they're going back. There are different kind of engagements that, you know, it's not just a migration out. You know, you go out and you gain some experience, and then you come back, or you feel the need that you have to go back. You know, you have to do something. So I think increasingly, I know of a child rights activist in Guwahati who studied here. Now he is now a well-known child rights activist there. So, you know, this kind of the engagement is not just that you are all going out and just sending money orders. It's and this guy who started this Blooming Manipur, it's like he is based in UK, but he is still engaging with the people of Manipur to grow flowers. So, you know, this there is a different kind of push and pulls that's happening. And that's a good sign, I believe.
Okay, so let me put another question to you. We have been talking so far, and I'll ask you one question, then we'll open it up for discussion. We've been talking so far of engaging with India, which was the title of the panel and so on. How about engaging with each other within the Northeast? What is happening there? And are there, for example, I've heard of things like fashion designers saying that they will basically showcase or re-find lost traditions and create clothing and sell it in the Northeast, create a market, entrepreneurs from the Northeast, that sort of thing. Is there a lot of that going on? Because there is, that is also India, right? The dialogue between those states is also important.
Well, I think that is happening. I mean, part of the real problem is we have never tried to explore each other's lives, traditions, histories. You know, the region we call our Northeast is sort of locked into this frame of, you know, the Nagas talk about themselves, the Manipuris about themselves, the Assamese are, you know, the fat cats and they're talking about themselves. You have Meghalaya and Arunachal and little Sikkim and Tripura, nobody talks about. But so that is a real problem, you know, of not engaging with each other. And there is very little exchange among the states. In fact, many people get to know each other when they come and share hostel rooms or come and live and work in Delhi. And I think that is something that needs to break down. And behavioral change, whether it's within a region like that or outside, is the perhaps one that any anthropologist, sociologist will tell you is one of the most difficult things. And we have to bring in changes in the curricula, in teaching, that, you know, embed some of these things so that people engage with them on a daily basis.
Yeah, which is where the kind of stories you were talking about comes in. But I want an additional question or just a comment to this. As I understand it, okay, the northeastern states need to engage with each other, but there is some engagement at the level of the women's movement, which has been ongoing with groups that cover the region, with connections between women. There are differences. It's not to say there are not differences. So you see that it's evident in Manipur when Iram Sharmila decided to give up her fast and so on. But there are engagements at the level of women's groups. And I think those need also to be showcased a lot.
One more thing I would like to say, that we had been victims of history as well, because during the colonial administration, all these outlying tribal areas were either excluded or partially excluded, and government did not encourage at all a exchange of views or people. Or so whatever in the past we had the relation, that died off during the colonial 200 years, and those effects are there. Now, with the advent of Western education and other things, a new level of engagement is starting now, and to a certain extent, this is political also.
Okay. So, can we...
Can I just make two quick points?
Quick points. We'll open it up, yeah.
One is that even next week, or this week, there's this big literary festival in Guwahati,
the
Brahmaputra River Festival, which is going to bring in all sorts of people. So that sort of thing is very important. It'll go some way. The other point I want to say is that, you know, we shouldn't be under the romantic illusion that everything is equal in the Northeast. For instance, right now, in Nagaland, women candidates for the municipal elections have been boycotted by NGOs which are male dominated. I mean, this is really a new patriarchy which is coming in. They won that after a six-year battle in the Supreme Court. I mean, think of the enormity of it. Those who contested the idea of India used the Constitution to assert their right to fight an election. And you have this male patriarchy which is saying, no, this is threatening our self-respect, which is not traditional. You can't do this, and we'll boycott you. So many of them have withdrawn from the contest. So there are many contests to be fought still.
Okay, so thank you, and you lots of questions, my goodness. Okay, so we'll take three or four from this side, let them answer, then we'll come that side, okay? So yes, sir, you, and then you after. Then that lady at the back, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, I'll come to you. Please, short question.
So Delhi, perhaps the way it's conducted itself, has lost the right to be the capital of India. Would it have been very different in terms of the inclusiveness of the marginal states, as we could call them for the purpose of discussion, had the capital of India been, let's say, Hyderabad, and where the administrative powers and the cultures had been different? Would it have been a different India that we were looking at?
So please just hold the questions, and we'll have a round of responses.
Yeah, I had some experience last year at Jodhpur, where a salesman said that we ship everything to everywhere in India. And we wanted to ship something to Sikkim, and there's, nahi madam, India mein bataiye, kahin bhi ho jayega. So how to deal with such people?
Okay, thank you. Yeah, over there, there are three people. So 1, 2, 3. Okay, fine, you can start from the back and come to this middle row.
Thank you for the session. I had two questions. One is, conventionally, you talked about the differences in looks.
Hold the mic.
Yeah, you talked about how the people from the Northeast look very different. But from the conventional sense, I would say, and a lot of people feel that they're quite beautiful, great skin, good hair. So what went terribly wrong about the perception about how Northeastern people look? So if you could just discuss about what went wrong in the history. See, there are stereotypes everywhere. South Indians, North Indians, Gujaratis, they're all biased. People are biased against them. But what went so terribly wrong, especially with the Northeast? My other question is, what is being done by the government on ground level, by central government and the government within the Northeast to resolve this problem? That's
okay.
It. Thank you.
Can you pass the mic to the middle row? There are three people there holding up their hands.
Hi. Thank you for that session. I just quickly wanted to understand, we're talking about a lot of marginalization with the context of the Northeast, but I'm sure there are marginalized communities within the Northeast. So for example, tribals, you touched upon, LGBT people. Can you throw some light on their condition and what's happening on those lines within the marginalized Northeast society? And how do you link that to the marginalization of these communities within the mainland?
Yeah, so I studied history for 2 years in high school, and I graduated in history from Delhi. And in 5 years, there was one line on the history of the Northeast. So, and this, I think it promotes this sort of casual racism that you find. Like, I had a classmate who was speaking to my friend from Arunachal, and he was like, so where the rest of your chinky gang? And he didn't think it was racist. He was referring to their physical features. And so what my question is really, at an institutional level, because we've talked about cultural festivals and everything, but how do you bring change at an institutional level, either, you know, in bureaucracy or in an educational institution which should really know better?
Thank you. Okay, do you want to respond first? And then we'll...
Can I take the last question
more,
first?
Sorry?
Okay. Let me take the last, because I'm going to forget all the others. So, very quickly. You know, what I mentioned to you at the beginning, the Delhi police asking for a module on sensitization of their personnel is, I think, an indicator of where things are. Because political pressure is being brought to bear on them. And there are many people in the bureaucracy and in politics who are influenced in Delhi. That's one thing. The second thing on the curriculum, you know, the last thing I did before I left Jamia and took up a new assignment was, there were 20 of us who got together and actually wrote a history paper for undergrad and postgrad students. And it is going to be taught at Jamia. It's going to be free for anybody, the history of the Northeast, a paper in the history curriculum. So, you know, we have to make efforts in every possible way. And even though our numbers are limited, we can do many things together. I think that's the key.
Sanjay has got a lot of faith in the bureaucracy and police administration. Bureaucracy is the last bastion to change even a millimeter. So I have got no faith that they will be able to deliver unless they are kicked up by the politicians that do this. So that is what is happening actually. The politicians' constituencies are threatened to certain extent by the, in different ways. And say they kuch to karo na iske liye. That is exactly what is happening at the moment, nothing beyond. I hope good comes of it. Within the Northeast, as my young friend asked, yes, there are a lot of marginalized groups. Many people, my main concern is that these people are losing their identities by losing their languages. If we take language as the first parameter of culture, losing the language is losing whole culture and identity. And that is what happening. It is threatening even language, big languages like Assamese. But in small tribal languages, where the speakers are 1 or 2 lakhs or even less than that, it's a big, big threat. These communities may disappear from the face of the earth by losing their language and thereby their first culture. We are aware of that. Let us put our heads together as to how we can help them.
I'm all for defying stereotypes, and I believe that this kind of one-to-one engagement with people, that is going to change the perceptions or whatever. We should stop depending on the government, on the bureaucrats and the police to do their job. It's time for us to engage with each other, talk to each other, and I think that therein lies the key.
Yeah, you can talk to each other until you are blue in the face, but unless the structure, you are able to impact the structure, you work on impacting and changing the structure, we'll keep talking to each other for another 20 years without change. So it's important to be strategic. It's important to have the force, not just of numbers, but of strategizing whatever you do so that it has an impact in one or two specific areas. That's why I talked about the history. That's why I talk about stereotyping and the Delhi police, which is terrible. But I think that we have to capture the openings when they're given, open the door fully or to some extent so that fresh air comes in. You know, this is the only way we're going to work. People change, attitudes change when people talk to each other, yes. But you have to also institutionalize it, and no matter how hard it is for the bureaucrat, at some point push will come to shove.
Okay, the battles always come at the end.
I have always the best wishes.
He's a bureaucrat.
And secondly, I have one thing.
Can we get some
say.
Questions?
Yes, before we start, one point I want to say. Yes, policy intervention is must.
The organizers, I'm so sorry. I didn't realize it would take so much time. I do apologize. Please ask it outside.
You can ask it outside. They'll be moving to the book signing area, sir. You can always...
Book signing. Thank you very much, everybody. Thank you, all of you.
Thanks a lot to our speakers for this enriching session.